Ladies and gentlemen, I work at the University of Zaragoza and Lluis Lujan, as Claire said, and first of all, I would like to thank this invitation for the speech this afternoon, and I would like to thank personally Claire Dwoskin and Yehuda Schoenfeld for supporting our research, and what I'm presenting today is common work together with the Institute of Agrobiotechnology in Pamplona. Okay, the autoimmune inflammatory syndrome induced by adjuvants, described in 2011 by Schoenfeld, is a syndrome that includes a variety of clinical conditions. You know, macrophagic myofasciitis, post-vaccinal phenomena, and others. We all know about that. All these conditions are linked by chronic stimulation of the immune system by adjuvants, either aluminium or silicon, and the reaction of the immune system is the induction sometimes of autoimmune inflammatory reactions linked to the application of vaccines. We observed in 2008 what we later describe as the Ovine ACS syndrome that was massively at that time detected and recognized, because at that time the blue tongue, a virus that severely affects sheep, arrived in Europe, and the European Commission decided that there should be a compulsory vaccination of sheep across Europe. Animals were normally vaccinated four times in a month. This means two vaccines applied one day to different strains of the virus, plus a booster 20 or 30 days later. And this means four vaccines in a month, and the aluminium contained in these vaccines were about 16 micrograms. I know we are been talking about much less concentrations, but in veterinary vaccines, the concentration of aluminium is much higher. Okay, almost immediately, a massive adverse reaction was observed by all working on that in Spain, and the disease consisted in two phases, what we call the acute phase, a few days after vaccination, and the chronic phase, months after inoculations, that was clearly influenced by external factors such as winter, such as cold. The acute phase, just to remind you, the acute phase will appear a few days after vaccination, we already said that, and affects a low proportion of animals. Normally less than 3%, 3% or even less. Most of them, even if the symptoms were very striking, most of those animals recover, only a few die. The acute phase was characterized by acute neurological signs, such as animals, as you see, totally unresponsive to stimulus, animals getting blind, getting lost, behaving very oddly. As this animal here, as you see, it is a sheep surrounded by people, and the animal doesn't move, doesn't escape. This is a very odd behavior for a sheep, not for a dog, but this is a sheep. Some of them, as I said, showed prostration and severe clinical signs, and that. Histologically, what we could see was meningoencephalitis with severe lesions across the brain, and even having these severe lesions, it is remarkable that most of these animals survived. Okay, the chronic phase came afterwards, and the chronic phase could affect a higher proportion of animals, much higher depending on the flocks, and this phase could appear months after vaccination, normally with winter, with the cold. This phase was rather different. It was characterized by extremely thin animals and weak, with very poor call aspect, and animals at the end showed ataxia, coma, and death. The lesions were again different because they were characterized by neurodegenerative lesions, normally located, the stronger lesions located in the spinal cord. This syndrome at that time induced massive losses of animals and production of flocks, severe detriment in production in flocks, a disaster, an economic and health disaster for those flocks. And it was a devastating wasting disease. As you can see, those years, 2008 and 10, there was an unexplained mortality of adult animals that has never been really explained. And that was linked to the use of those vaccines. Of course, this was very, very commented, or there were many news in the everywhere in newspapers, but there were never an answer to what happened. Let me stop here and make some important remarks, and I think I need to say here, because you may not know that we did a complete study, not only us, but many other research teams did a study on this process, and all known ovine diseases were disregarded. So this was clearly something very new. And regarding vaccines in ovine production, I have to say that at least in Spain they are widely used. They are given at any age. They are given once or twice every year. I mean, depending, the same vaccine can be given one or twice every year, and all of them contain adjuvants. Normally aluminium, in the case of sheep, is 95% of them, and at a concentration much higher than the human beings. So the end result is that a flock can be inoculated with adjuvants 4 to 10 times per year. So we, at that time, we did experimental reproduction that was done only with 6 animals, 3 controls and 3 vaccinated, in a flock that had no history of vaccinations. And we did a work on during 9 months where we vaccinated animals 14 times with 14 doses of commercial vaccines along seven of these 9 months. The final amount those animals got in terms of aluminium hydroxide was 54 micrograms, and we could see some difference. For instance, in the weight of the vaccinated animals, there was a clear tendency that was significant by, at this point, that coincide with the winter cold, and the final weight differed between the two groups. It is true that the two groups were simply too small, but there was a difference in this experiment. In addition, those animals showed the vaccinated animals showed generalized weakness and altered behavior that normally were alternative periods of depression or excitation. The animals were totally unresponsive at the end of the experiment, as you can see here. This animal is resting and is totally unresponsive, whereas the control is rather bright and alive. The lesions we saw in these animals, the CNS lesions were similar to those that had been seen in the field, and we had some data showing that there was accumulation of aluminium in the nervous tissue of vaccinated animals. Clearly, that experiment was a first approach, but it needs to be said that there was a low number of experimental animals, so we decided to see to engage ourselves in a much bigger experiment, which is what I'm presenting here today, including many more animals to see the effect of intensive vaccination, which is what happened in our conditions, in these animals. So what we are planning to do in this experiment, we are working right now, all animals by now are still alive, is a combination of clinicopathological research in the animals, studying either symptoms or all the blood parameters and biochemistry profiles we can study the behavior, study the immune responses together with our colleagues at the Institute of Agrobiotechnology, studying the macrophage differentiation profile, expression of activation molecules, the generation of autoantibodies, this in collaboration with Yehuda Schoenfeld and any other on a other immune response that we can study. We will study the pathology. This is not has not been done yet because they are all alive, so this will be very interesting. And hopefully in the future, in collaboration with Chris Exley, we'll study the concentration of aluminium in tissues, especially in the nervous tissue, and even the activation of genes after over-immunization. This is still, of course, to be done. What I'm presenting here today is just the first bit, and as always, all congresses come too early, and some of these things are not yet studied. We are generating tons of data, and we still need to go through them, but some of them are already indicating very interesting things, as you will see. We have been working with four groups of male lambs, 21 animals in each group, that are integrated in four different flocks that are representative of production systems, weather, and things that of veterinary interest. So we are working with a total of 84 lambs. These four flocks, here you have a picture of them, are located in different places. Some are purebred or crossbred, and as I said, are different depending on the production system. I want to mention this one. This one is the flock in the veterinary faculty, which is we call it stress-free because they are kept in ideal conditions. They do nothing really, and so. This is the control of the other groups that are mixed in real flocks. What we do with these animals is, of these 21 animals, were subdivided in three subgroups, and one got PBS, the other one got vaccines, and the other one got adjuvant alone. Interestingly, and I want to mention this, in these outside flocks, the subgroups are pulled as a single group in each flock. So they live together, so they are in close contact. And in the faculty, the subgroups are housed separately. They don't see each other. And this makes a difference, as you will see. This is the vaccination schedule we've been doing for 15 months. We started here more or less in February. Last year, we are right now here, and we are still giving the last doses of vaccine during this week, some of our colleagues, of course. And this is an intensive schedule, but the recommended posology and the recommended procedure has always accomplished. These are the vaccines, they are all commercial vaccines used in sheep production. Okay. All these vaccines contain aluminium as adjuvant in a range of more or less 2 milligrams, and the total amount of aluminium they will receive will be 72 milligrams in more or less 18 months. Yeah. If you see the content of aluminium in this is a single dose, you know, it's much higher than what happens in human. And these are common pathogens in sheep, including the bluetongue virus. Okay, what we are doing, so our periodic clinical examination, you know, standard clinical examinations, neurological clinical examinations, where we study the reflexes, the mental status, hematology, biopathology, serology. We are generating an incredible amount of data. And we are also studying the stress response by measuring cortisol and lactate. We are studying, of course, the weight of those animals. And in flock one, only in flock one, the one we have at the faculty, what we are doing is cognitive and behavioral test, you know, the Ovine T maze test. So the animal is placed, it's placed here, so the animal has to find the way through this corridor and found, you know, there is a speaker here with noise of animal noise, so the animal has to find the way, or there is food in here, so the animal has to do this path, and the following day the animal repeats this. So we learn, we know if the animals can learn the what they did the day before. There is an open field test where the animal is placed in an open field test, and then there are many measures to be taken. The animal is left for 5 minutes here, and then all these measures there are many parameters to be measured. And also we are doing a recording of the animals to record the social behavior, because, you know, these animals do not show the behavior if you are in front of them. They do nothing, they simply escape from you. And to see the changes in the behavior, you really need to record that for 12 hours during 7 days the same week, and then study that. So this is a long procedure, and we are still doing that, but you will see there are interesting things. Regarding clinical and neurological examination, what we are seeing, and this is rather clear, that the inoculation site, I have to say all vaccines are subcutaneous. No vaccine is intramuscular, so this makes a difference. The inoculation site and the lymph node reaction in vaccinated and adjuvant inoculated animals are always more severe, depending on the concentration of aluminium, and are always more severe if we compare the vaccine together with the with the inoculation of aluminium alone with equal concentration of aluminium. I didn't say, I have to mention that for each vaccine we inoculate, we measure the contain of aluminium, and we inoculate in the aluminium control, in the aluminium group, exactly the same amount. There are clinical observations in these animals, like for instance, losing some reflexes. In flock one, we clearly see that the extensor reflex in the forelimb was lost, or hyposensitivity in trunk and limbs, or in other flocks, tendency to lordosis and trunk muscle atrophy. Okay, I'm finished now, no problem. I have to say, the T-maze test and the open field test done so far did show no significant differences, but this still needs to be further studied, and still analysis to go. But there is a behavioral change that is very surprising, which is the wool biting. This, of course, you don't know about this, but this is a very common problem in many flocks that nobody knows where it does come from, but when it starts in a flock, it's almost impossible to remove. Okay, animals bite and pull out the wool of the rest, and we have seen that in flock one, only in the vaccinated group, but in the rest of flocks, in all subgroups. And I want to remind you that all these subgroups in the these three flocks, the animals are pulled together, whereas here, the subgroups are housed separately. And as I said, a very common problem. And let me show you what is this. You know, this is a compulsive behavior, you know, and many times the farmers blame they are bored, animals are bored, they don't know what to do. You know, our controls don't do that. And they are as bored as their colleagues nearby. So clearly this is a behavioral change in animals that have been vaccinated as the only difference. In the other groups, this is what they call contagious behavior. So a group starts and then everybody starts, and then it's a kind of nightmare. Let me show what is in another. This is in flock two. Let me show what is a compulsive behavior in an animal. And this, as I said, is a very common problem. We never know where it does come from. Of course, many other things have been blamed, mineral deficiencies, many other fiber deficiencies, but never get a solution. And we know now that this is, at least in our conditions, induced by vaccination. This leads animals to with loss of wool and poor coat aspect that reminds the beginning of the process we really saw some years ago in the Asia crisis. The methodology shows no changes at all so far. This is also very compatible with what we saw in the cases of Asia many years ago, where there were no hematological changes. And regarding the weight, I have to say that there are differences between groups. This is the group in the faculty, and these animals don't show any difference. These are the three groups, and this line here is the temperature. Okay, the other groups, the vaccinated group, which is the red line, show a tendency to be below the other groups, but there are no significant differences because the standard deviations that are not shown here are just too big. And even if we get differences similar to the one we got some years ago, these differences are not significant, and we can only talk about tendencies. Certainly there are individuals that are badly affected, like this one or this one, so it will be very interesting to see the pathology of these animals. And finally, to end up, we did a measurement of cortisol and lactate, which are molecules for stress, for measuring the stress, and you can see that in September, both molecules show no significant differences in the three groups we have here. But in January, the winter, I have to say that the warmest winter in humankind did not help much. But anyway, there are very significant differences between the vaccinated and the adjuvanted group, together with the control. So this means these animals are really stressed. So, and the only difference, this is again made in the more controlled flock, the one we have at the faculty, these animals are simply stressed by vaccination. So the conclusion so far, there will be many more in the future, but so far we can say that the vaccinated subgroup exhibits behavioral changes, especially wool biting, compulsive wool biting, especially at winter time. The vaccinated subgroups also exhibit an array of clinical neuropathological changes. And as I said, the weight shows a tendency to decrease, but there is a huge variation between animals and vaccinated animals, and it's impossible to get a significant value there. And those animals are stressed. We can say that. Those animals are stressed, simply. by over vaccination, and this possibly is linked to their behavior. So this is all, and I want to thank all my colleagues. I forgot a picture with my colleagues working at the faculty or at the institution of agrobiotechnology. Thank you very much.